Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So glad to see everybody here this week. Like I said again, I know, especially if you're a teacher, you're very excited that you got some time off this week. I know you're excited about that. But I just want to say a special thank you this morning before we go any further. We have had a lot of folks that have served and worked incredibly hard helping with Operation Christmas Child. So definitely, if you have given in any capacity with those boxes, or you have done some work down at the net this week helping with that, with the loading and all the things that went on with that, I just want to say thank you. Y'all did an amazing job. And I just want you to know, from a pastor standpoint, it just feels great to be a part of something that's going on around the world and know that we were a part of a project that's going to get the gospel to kids all across the planet. So again, to everybody that served in any way with Operation Christmas Child, just thank you so much. Then I also would like to just take a moment to wish everybody a great Thanksgiving. This is an important time just in our lives, for our families. We'll get opportunities to reconnect with people maybe that we've not seen in a while. We'll have a little bit of a downtime, but in the midst of that, I just want to encourage you as your pastor, I just want to encourage you, will you make sure that you take time to be thankful? It's time to just bow our heads, bend our hearts, and realize that God has been really good to us in the midst of a crazy year. So what we're going to do, we're going to just take a moment of silence, and I want to ask you just right now in the service, will you just go ahead and take the time to go, Lord, thank you. Thank you for what you've done for me. Thank you for what you've done for our church. Thank you for how you continue to move and act in our community. So let's take just a moment to be thankful.
Good morning. All right, if you'll stand with us, we're going to sing.
Yeah. Seated because we're going to keep worshiping. So I'd invite you to stand again. We're going to learn a new song this morning. Just to kind of tell you what this is all about. You know, after every victory, there's a story to be told, a song to be sung. And with this next song, we're going to declare that God is a deliverer. We're going to declare that He's the one who leads us out of the desert. You know, the most powerful sound on earth is the song of captives set free. There's power in our testimony that releases hope to the world. As we sing this next song, I want you to think about your own story. Let's turn it into a song of thankfulness, allowing the hope that lives inside of us to permeate the world. I think the Passion Translation of Psalm 107, verse 2 kind of says it best. Tell the world how He broke through and delivered you from the power of darkness. This song is called Let the Redeemed.
There's something powerful about a great redemption story. On Monday of this week, I heard one of those. There's a lady that's been a friend of our family for probably about 4 years now. I really didn't know her backstory. I do now. What I didn't realize that when she was 17 years old is that her mom took her life through addiction. Her mom had an overdose and her life changed. And so at 17 years old, she was a young lady without Christ and walked through a very difficult journey, walked through the life that she had lived, and the home that she grew up in was one of much pain and much sorrow. Well, as an adult, her and her husband have now both come to faith in Jesus and have a walk with Christ. And so that's what we've known, is her life now. And what happened is you find out the rest of the story is then what happens now for years. She doesn't want to drive by the house where she grew up. Man, I get that. I mean, think about it. That's the home you grew up in. And it's just remembrances of pain, of sorrow, of addiction, of abuse. Man, who wants to drive by and remember that stuff? Well, last week, she drove by. And when she drove up, she knew something was different. The home where she grew up is now has a sign in front of it, and it's now a women's ministry for women that are recovering from addiction. So who else would do that but God? I mean, I want you to think about that for a moment. To take a place that was a place of pain, it was a place of sorrow, it was a place where addiction took over the life of a lady. And God has now taken this home, and again, it's a place where now people are delivered, they're redeemed, and they're set free. Well, the idea of a redemption story has been the message of the Bible from the very beginning all the way through the end. God is continuing to write his story of redeeming, of rescuing, and delivering. So in the Old Testament, some examples that we see that it tells us about God redeemed his people from slavery in Egypt. We talked about that just a few weeks ago. God also redeemed Israel from Babylonian captivity. We know in the book of Job, Job makes reference to that he understands that he has a living redeemer. The psalmist in multiple places in the Psalms, it says that they're asking for redemption from times of distress. We also know in the Old Testament that the psalmist testified of God's redeeming work. An example of that would be Psalm 19:14, where he says, "The Lord is my rock. He's my redeemer. In him will I trust." This life is difficult some days, some weeks, some years. It is good for us to be reminded that the Lord is in the act of redeeming. It's been his story from the very, very beginning. So again, the Lord is my rock. He is my redeemer. In him will I trust. Well, there are three Hebrew words that are used in the Old Testament to give further, deeper expression of what this idea of redemption means. Here's the very first one. This word is referring to the redemption of people or any living things. So here's my best example. Back in the day, at the time that this word was first used there in the Hebrew language, what would have happened? A gentleman owned an ox. Somehow that ox is then got, either the gate was left open, he broke through it, and he leaves the property of his owner. In the midst of that, he winds up goring a young man's son to death. By penalty of the law, what would happen is now both the owner and the ox, now by penalty, they should be stoned to death. So that is what would happen. But here's where redemption kicks in. If the father that lost the son, if he will accept it, then the owner of the ox could pay what was referred to as the redemption price. And if he would receive that redemption price, then guess what happens? Then the ox and the owner, they live. They live. The second one we look at is this word, and it refers to what is called the kinsman redeemer. A very important thought for us today. And the idea of the kinsman redeemer would be this. As a family member, if you are the next of kin, if someone that you are next of kin to receives a debt, then it is your responsibility to go to take care of that debt. So the example that we would see, this would be someone that has a debt, so they sell themselves into slavery to cover that debt. What happens then? The kinsman redeemer steps forward, says, I am the next of kin, I will cover that debt and buy their freedom out of that slavery. The next example we see in Scripture would be one example I could think of, would be where there is a lady that is now a widow. Her husband has passed, so what happens? She has debt upon her land that now she no longer has her husband to assist her with covering the debt of that land since he is gone. So the kinsman redeemer is the next of kin, and he steps up and he says, I will cover any debt that has been incurred by you and by your family. So that was our second one, the idea of the kinsman redeemer. The next one, again, no jokes here, but this one is called the Kippur. And so it's where the Jews get the idea of Yom Kippur. It is the most holy day for the Jewish people. It's the day of atonement. It's a day of covering. It's a day to celebrate that your sin has been covered. It has been washed clean, and it is pure. Well, the New Testament, the message of redemption continues. Redemption is found in Jesus, no other. That reminder of the truth today that Jesus specifically came, it was a deliberate act on his part that he came to sacrifice his life for the sin of the world. And the idea in the New Testament, again, of redemption is to buy or to buy out. Here's what is implied in the words that are used in the New Testament referring to redemption. It's this person is purchased from slavery, not for a job to do, but they're purchased out of slavery for the purpose that they're going to be set free. I want you to think about that. Typically, when someone purchased a slave, they were purchasing them for a job that they were going to give them to do. But the idea of the New Testament, the idea of Jesus and redemption is, you're being purchased just to let you free. It's also implied there is that they would never be sold again. That relationship then with God, that redemption that comes from God is, from that point forward, the rest of their days, they're in freedom. Examples in the New Testament is Acts 20:28. It says that he purchased the church with his own blood. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 18 says, we were ransomed with the precious blood of Jesus. I want you to think about that. We had a ransom. We were being held captive. And Jesus and his blood is what paid the price for us to be received, to be set free. We also see in Titus 2:14, it says, Jesus gave himself to redeem us and to purify us. How come? For good works. John 6:51 says, he gave his flesh for the life of the world. John 10:11 says, he's the good shepherd that lays down his life for the sheep. Also, it tells us in John 1:29 that he is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. I don't know for us if we realize the significance of that statement, but especially for those with that Jewish heritage, that meant the world to them when they heard that Jesus was the Lamb, the pure, spotless, perfect Lamb of God. And he's the one, and his sacrifice is the one that covers our sin. And then one last passage from the New Testament is Revelation. Revelation chapter 5, verses 8 through 14. And what we see in those verses, John receives this amazing revelation from God, and he gets a glimpse into heaven. And what does he see? He sees this mass of people from every tribe, every nation, every language of the world. And they're praising Jesus because it was through his blood that they were saved. It's through his blood that they were set free. And then Psalm 107:2 says it this way. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble. There are many stories that could be told of redemption. I began the service today with simply telling one of someone that's a part of our, that knows our family, that's connected to our family again, but to hear her story just makes so much sense of what God's done to create her to be the lady that she is. And can you imagine the freedom that she feels now? To know that that home that she grew up in, that was a place of sorrow and pain, is now a place where ladies can go and be redeemed. Well, I believe that we need to give opportunity for the redeemed of the Lord to say so. I'm going to ask Jake Anderson to please make his way this direction. And Jake's going to tell his story of redemption.
Well, this has been probably about a year and a half coming. I sent Pastor Kip and James at the time my testimony one day when we were just texting. Kind of like, anytime y'all can use this, I would like y'all to use it. I just feel like the Lord's laid this on me. Then about a month ago, Pastor Kip asked me to do this again, and I'm like, oh boy, you know, it kind of came real. So I was a little nervous, and it took me about a month to rewrite it out and send it back to him. And it's been like, the devil's been working, trying, you don't need to do this, you know, this is, you can't handle this type thing. So today, this is my testimony, which takes a lot of courage for me. I'm not a speaker. So at the age of probably 5, my dad actually had a cancer, died. We had a successful business in Gulfport with 7 kids. At 5 years old, he got cancer. In 6 months, he was gone. After that, mother started kind of doing her own little thing. She started going out, doing things with 4 kids at home. 3 were already gone. At this time, she kind of felt convicted, so she would take us to church on weekends, on Sundays, you know, party Saturday night, church on Sunday for the kids. Well, we went from church to church. Each time someone said something to my mom, she would get, feel convicted, so we'd move churches. So we'd stay a couple months here, a couple months there. Well, we went to one church, and I went to a Bible study for kids, and I actually accepted the Lord at 7 years old. Got baptized, kind of was knew a lot what it was, but I didn't. Kind of seven. You always have questions. Well, things tend to get a little worse after that. Mom actually met her a beau, but he was alcoholic. So he moved in with us. We stayed in bar rooms all the time from 1 to 2 in the morning. It's 7, 8 years old. We would be playing pool, doing things like that. Well, during the summers, one of my oldest brother was basically a drug dealer and an addict. So we would get sent to Gulfport. And we lived with him. So we watched him shoot up heroin, OD, and shake, and driving down the road, got to pull over because he's OD in the car, getting moved over, selling drugs out of the house, things like that. That was father figures for me at that age because I didn't have any. Later on, we moved back. Mom married another guy. He has 4 kids. So now there's 8 kids in the house and 2 people. So we're still just up in the air with a bunch of things, and at that age, you don't know what's going on really. It's kind of like a blur. This happens, then that happens, and we move kids in the house, and you got other kids. By this time, I think it was around 9, 10, I actually started working. So I'd go to watermelon fields and drive trucks for them, ride around just to get out of the house. Do things like that, and before you know it, I'm actually driving to work at 10, 11 years old. So I flip F-150 or F-100 at 11 years old 3 times in the middle of the road. Walk away from it. just doo-doo-doo, okay, nothing happened. A little bruise on the shoulder, I'm good. Then probably right after that, I get tired of going to Gulfport, so my other brother lives in Long Beach. So at 12 years old, I start driving from Silver Run all the way to Long Beach by myself, just to get out of the house, scenario stuff, just to stay away, things like that. Well, you know, as you get older, teenagers come in, you do things you actually not proud of, a lot of things. Just kind of, probably about 16 buddies are out drinking and all this. I fall out of a truck, they run over me with an S10, literally run slap over me. Walked away from that one. So then we actually go, and about, I get a job, I quit school with 10th grade, get a job, start working. Been doing that for a year or two. My older brother, the one that's on drugs, finally cleaned up, got married, moved to Wiggins, does things. After that, he called me one Sunday, he's like, hey, I want to cook you breakfast. I'm like, good, okay, that's fine, yeah, good. I'm like, but I'm kind of tired, I stayed out all night last night. So the next night I go to hockey and get up about 1 o'clock in the morning, get a phone call. Johnny's dead. So he got killed the very next day in a car accident. So then you're like, I'm too lazy to get up and go see my brother, and he dies the next day. So then you're carrying the burden of that. In the middle of all this, somebody invites me to it. Well, after all that, my other brother, 2 years under him, is diagnosed as sick. Don't know how long he'll make it. So I get invited to a sing, and I go to the sing, and out there, the Lord talked to me again. I rededicated my life. The only problem with that is I didn't have a church life. So there you go, slipping back into the same old thing. You're back, same rut, going out with friends, doing things like that. Well, some things go down with my mom and them. I finally move out. I just get kind of solitude. Well, I don't want anybody around, got my own little thing, and then ended up meeting my wife. Didn't go right the first time. Second time went really good. So we ended up getting married after about a year. And then after about a year, we found out we were pregnant. We went to little churches, where I worked, there was a guy that had a rough life. He actually turned out to be a pastor. He was going to working with me to be a pastor. I don't know if anybody heard of Lowry Anderson, J.J. Jasper's father-in-law. So I worked with him for a while. And, you know, the Lord puts people in your life for weird things you have no clue about. So I worked with him for about 2 years. We worked out the gym, did all kinds of things. But needless to say, I met my wife. We get married. 2 years later, find out I'm having a son or a kid. I'm like, Lindsay, we got to change. I'm not raising my son the way I was raised and having this kind of life and this thing. Something's got to change. So from that point on, we have been pretty faithful to the Lord, and just he's worked on me ways that nobody could ever imagine, because I should be a statistic of the life that being around all the drugs. I should have went that way. I should have been killed 5 or 6 times. And 3 days after we got married, my other brother died. So I've lost two brothers and a father already. So there's only 5 of us, 4 of us left in our family. Not only that, wife had open heart surgery 1.5 years ago. So he has tested us very well. But my faith is in him like nothing could ever move. Just because even through her situation, everybody's like, "Hi, ain't you worried?" I said, "The Lord's got it." And to me, from when I was 7 years old, he got me, and he kept me right where he needed me to be throughout that time. Even though it was through trials and tribulations, and I seen this and done that, if that wouldn't have happened, I wouldn't be the man I am today to my son. Even though I didn't have an earthly father, I had a heavenly father that taught me many things more than any earthly father probably could have taught me. And could have saved me from so many things. And you can ask my son, he's tough on me. But I've been there, done that. And I know where the Lord's led me throughout everything in my life to create the man he's created today for the son that's going to be greater than me, is what I'm trying to do. And I thank y'all for the time.
Hey, everybody say amen.
Amen.
Well, Well, I want to share with you again a story that I've told you before, but it's probably my favorite illustration of all time. The redemption story. Growing up in Baton Rouge, I'm sure they had it in other cities as well all across the country. But, you know, my grandma pretty much stayed with her starting from when I was 2 weeks old on. And she lived right across the street even from the elementary school I went to. So my parents dropped me off there in the morning, picked me up in the evening. So grandma had a big influence in my life. And so one of the things that she did, she collected top value stamps and S&H green stamps. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? So, and one of my jobs as a kid was to take all them stamps and put them in the book for her. And so that along with shelling peas and a whole lot of other things that got was my jobs along the way. But I remember vividly as a kid, grandma took me to, and I think it's interesting, again, that's what it was called. It was the redemption store. And so we went there, and I will remember it just as if it was just a minute ago. And I remember seeing this football and a kicking tee sitting on the top shelf. And I was like, man, I sure would love to have that football and that kicking tee. And so I had to figure out, how much is it going to cost? Because if you remember anything about those kind of stores, you didn't pay money. That's not what you could do. It wasn't a store where you go and you pay a money price. You had to pay it in the stamps. So once again, we had collected those, and I'd help grandma, and I'd organize them and put them in the books. But we didn't have enough. So that meant, okay, it's going to take a little time. And so I still remember when we finally had enough. And grandma took me to the redemption store. And I still remember that football and that kicking tee was on the top shelf. They took it down. It was dusty. But man, that thing looked amazing. And so I was able to then, because of my grandma's help, to deliver the books that were necessary to buy that football and that kicking tee. And I want to state the obvious. A football and a kicking tee are never meant to be on a shelf. That is not what they were created for. They were created to be taken out and to be thrown and ran with, kicked, punted, and have fun. Our front yard was the neighborhood football field. We had these two trees that were all bordered on the neighbor's house. Man, that was like the perfect field goal. You know, that thing got kicked many a day, many times. There's many a days that, again, all the kids in the neighborhood, man, everybody met, and we had some great football games with that football and that kicking tee. Well, there's a price that had to be paid in the redemption store for that to be bought and for it to be set free to serve its purpose. Y'all, life was never meant to be lived on a shelf. And there's a lot of people in our world that they're just, life's on a shelf. And they're not living out their purpose. They're not living out what God put them here to do and to be. People need to be redeemed. People need to be delivered. They need to be set free. The message of redemption has been the same from the very beginning of the Bible all the way through. It's only available through the Lord. It's only through the Lord. So what are our truths for today, both through the scriptures that we looked at quickly, through the incredible message that we know of Jake's life and how God's writing that amazing redemption story. So let's take a look at just a couple things together today. Here's number one. Jesus paid the redemption price so that our penalty was removed and we could live. Y'all, we were guilty because of our sinfulness. We should have been put to death. Okay, y'all remember that word, that first one we looked at from the Hebrew? But if the Father in that situation would receive the redemption price, then what happened? It was forgiven, and they were set free to go live. So again, Jesus paid the redemption price. The Father was pleased with that sacrifice, and through him, again, we are set free to go live. Number two, Jesus bought us so that we could be free and never be slaves again. Jesus paid the price, and he purchased it at a price that was his own precious blood. He didn't purchase us for us to continue to be slaves to sin. Again, he purchased us to be set free to go live out our purpose. And the number three, very simply, was that verse from Psalms. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. This is very simple. But if you were to go through and be rescued from some big, great, tragic life thing, and you were rescued, wouldn't you tell everybody? Man, y'all would post it. Y'all would tell everybody that you met. You would tell your story. So, Jake, thanks for telling your story today. I pray it inspired somebody to realize God's still writing our story. Y'all, as long as you got breath left in you, God is writing your story. Let's let him redeem. Let's let him forgive us. And then let us go out and go get off the shelf and go live out and serve his purposes. So, to all those of you here today that are redeemed, tell somebody. Tell somebody what the Lord did for you. Well, Rossi's going to be on his way here, and we're going to close out with one song today. It's not going to surprise you that it's going to be a song called Redeemed. And I want to encourage you again. Maybe it's one you don't know. Maybe it's one you've heard a few times. But if you will, let's stand. Let's sing. the end. Amen. You guys, I hope you were encouraged today to be in the house of God. It's a week of thankfulness, and I encourage you, let's live that out this week. And again, don't be silent about what God has done for you and your family. He has blessed us. He is a good God.